Thank you, Ravin. Thank you for your wonderful introduction. This is actually, let me face all of you. One of the most interesting panels, given that co-working spaces are synonymous with being cool, you know? And all of you are leaders in this particular domain. So if I start, why don't we do a quick round of introduction starting from you, Meshu, and like a 30-seconder.
Yeah, thanks for limiting it to 30 seconds. Hi, I'm Meshu. I'm one of the co-founders and CEO for GoHive. We're building a community-based co-working space. So we believe that people come to offices, to co-working spaces, to collaborate and to learn from each other and not just limited to the workspace that they get. So that's the basic premise of setting up GoHive as a workspace, as a service.
Hi, I'm Anu. I'm the founder and CEO of Oxford Caps. We are targeting a very niche segment of student housing within the whole co-living domain. We are present in Singapore and India. We manage about 10,000 beds across 10 different cities in India. And we've been doing this for almost 2 years now.
Hi, I'm Sudeep Singh. I run GoWork and also one of the founders. We have in total about 1 million square feet just in Gurgaon as co-working, and we've also been termed as the largest co-working campus in the world.
Hi, I'm Nidhi. I'm the CEO and co-founder for YourSpace. Migration is a growing trend in India, and thereby the need for housing will always continue. We're also betting on the education sector, which is where we are also looking at the student housing sector. We started our journey 3 years ago, and today we're present in 7 cities and looking to become India's most trusted and loved brand of student housing.
Hi, my name is Bharat Khetan. I'm promoter for Worknomic. We are basically launching a concept where we are saying that the office space now needs to become more sustainable and ergonomic in terms of services. So we are basically sustainable and ergonomic serviced workspaces.
Thank you. Meshu, I'll start with you. My first question is the rise of co-working spaces an indication of the coming of age of gig economy? Is it the indicator of that, according to you?
Yeah, I mean, to a definitely to a large extent, yes. That's where the concept of co-working or a flexible office space started. When we started our journey about 2 years ago, that's the kind of customer base that we were catering to, and I think most of the co-working spaces were. However, to say that it's just probably an indication of gig economy, I think co-working is solving a much bigger problem today. We don't talk about just the startups or people who are not looking to afford or not able to afford, let's say, workspace. It's also taking the hassle away from most of the larger enterprises as well. And that's the reason we see most of the larger companies today, they look at flexible office space as a solution across cities. So while you're looking at, let's say, a satellite office, you know, when we look at statistics today, probably about 8 or 9% of the office space is consumed by flexible office spaces in India today. This is expected to go up to about 25% over the next 2 years. And the reason being, a lot of larger companies have also started to look at it as a solution. And we believe that apart from probably the HQs, companies would eventually want to move to, you know, non-committable, flexible office space, wherein they're not saying getting into long leases or long commitments. They want the flexibility of the growth, whether going up or going down.
Before I come to you, Anu, I want to go to Sudeep on the same question. What are your thoughts on this?
See, co-working has evolved as an industry. If you've noticed, you know, and let's go back about a decade ago when nobody heard the word co-working. But co-working actually existed in the form of incubators. So from incubators, you know, the concept grew and turned out another concept called accelerators, where you would, you know, offer a certain amount of services to the startups who would, you know, sit out of your space. From accelerators, then got co-working. And now co-working has moved into a different domain, which is the actual gig economy, which is managed service offices. And though we are termed as a co-working player, but we've always been a managed service offices for larger corporates and larger team sizes. So I think what we're trying to solve the problem is to give a flexible space to a larger company on a long-term basis and help them solve their problems of employee retention, employee benefits, employee satisfaction, so that it's easier for them to engage and retain their employees.
Bharat, your thoughts?
So when we talk about co-working spaces, as the word co in the working is collaborative, so let's bifurcate it into two parts. The first is, yes, the gig economy part of it. So most of the freelancers who are coming in now have a workspace that they can go and use in terms of flexibility. It also acts as a marketing platform for them, so they're able to get the customers themselves. And the other part is, as Sudeep was also saying, is the corporates and the larger companies who are looking for such people and want the flexible spaces. So the idea is to bring out the efficiency in the spaces when it's a mixture of both, and we talk about the co, that is the collaborative and the community part of the working space. That's where I think the gig economy plays its role.
For the audience, Anu and Nidhi are in the co-living domain, which is also catching up. So what Nidhi just told me, that co-living is like a hotel business on steroids, That's how she defined it, So how is the co-living space catching up, Anu, if I have to ask you? What are the trend? Is it actually getting the way co-working spaces are catching up? Where do we stand in that domain?
So co-living, I think it's slightly different from co-working in that it's a B2C, complete B2C domain. But if you look at the general trend of the sharing economy, as millennials and Gen Z, we are moving towards an asset-light life. Generally, right? We want to rent furniture, we don't want to buy cars, everything is becoming asset light. And so is the living experience. If you see globally, home ownership has gone down in like double digits as of last year. So that is really the trend. And as home ownership goes down, of course, people are looking for more feasible alternative rental accommodation options. And that's where co-living has really come in. That while there is one practical aspect of co-living that, okay, you need to have rental accommodation, there are people who have done kind of picked up specific niches of that. Somebody's kind of really preying on a niche community experience, just like maybe a WeWork did. That was the core of the product. Similarly, in co-living, there are companies who are just playing on the niche community experience. They're targeting, say, a homogeneous community of, let's say, gig workers or expats, right? So there are a couple of players who are coming up even with these niche expertise. On that side, we are basically just focused on students, which are university students, be it undergrads, masters, PhDs, because we believe that students have a very specific homogeneous pattern of demand. And that's to meet that demand, there is a very specific kind of supply that needs to be created. There's a very specific kind of experience that needs to be created. And that's what we are kind of really focused on. If you talk of just student housing is not a startup industry in any other part of the world. It's a very mature real estate asset class. There are listed companies and REITs, real estate investment trust of student housing. So as such, it's only Asia Pacific where student housing really hasn't picked up as a formal category. But in any other developed parts of the world, it's a very well matured asset class as such.
Nidhi, do you agree that a lot still needs to be covered in this domain?
Absolutely. So, I mean, I absolutely agree with what Anu was saying. And just to add to that, today the co-living market is largely unorganized. So today, till today, only 1% of the market is actually is operated by organized players. So there's a long way to go in terms of actual penetration into the market. Like I said, and like Anu said, migration, the country is becoming mobile. People from tier three cities are wanting to move to tier two to tier one, and that sort of phenomena will continue in the long run, and that will continuously create a demand for housing. And like in the West, this non-ownership of asset, the non-committal bit of it, I think is catching on. And I think as long as that continues, there will be a demand for co-living spaces. I think additionally, one more thing that, our research tells us is there is an element of loneliness, right? As people get to that age of 22, 23, move to a new city, meeting friends, meeting people. I think that is a very valuable insight we got when we spoke to a lot of these early kids in their first jobs, or kids who moved to new cities. And I think this co-living, this co-element of it, I think kind of solves for that. It brings together like-minded people. It brings together people in the same stage of their lives together. And I think that's what the value in this whole thing eventually will be, I think.
Sudeep, we're discussing that in this domain, you cannot play the valuation game as in other business and entrepreneurial setups. And it's also, co-working is not just a space that you rent, it's also a community that you build. Tell me, what are the biggest challenges for you as someone who is in this space, operating in this space, the three top challenges that you face?
I think, according to my experience, the biggest challenge when we started out with this concept was, like I said, we were not for startups. Our co-working spaces were not meant for startups. We were meant for large team sizes. So convincing a company to actually work in a domain, in a cool environment, at that point of time, used to be frowned upon because they didn't want their employees to get disturbed. But when we actually got them to help or solve the problems that they had of employee retention, so just to give you an example, we have we built a frustration room. Where employees can actually go and break stuff right on the wall, just vent out their frustration, which is, I think every 5 minutes I would have somebody doing.
There's no way to do this in their office.
Absolutely. Then we've introduced, Japanese capsules, sleeping pods, for employees to actually, come and rest. So there is we have certain companies who are, from Japan, and they have a culture of taking a nap in the afternoon. So that was very well received. And it is known for that all these things also help in, boosting productivity. The third aspect we focused upon was health. So for fitness and health, we have yoga studio built in-house. We've got a gymnasium built in-house. And alongside, we had to solve the problem in terms of food. So we've tied up with Radisson, where we're giving them gourmet meals at under 100 rupees, and very healthy meals. So all these aspects, when we got together and made form a product, and we actually went out to our customer and we told them that this is what we can solve you, help solve for you. I think this became they actually understood the value prop. The second aspect, the challenge that we faced was, and this is unique for the entire scenario, is that while everybody at the competition was grabbing ground, we had to retain ourselves and stay put at one place, because from day one we knew evaluation will not work in this game. I still believe that evaluation, post the WeWork fiasco that we all saw, this is a real estate space and there's no valuation here. Maybe you'll fetch a 3x valuation, but not actually 20x at one point of time. So while everybody was spreading their wings across grabbing the ground, we had to stay put, and that was a really, really difficult situation for us, and to even tell our customers about it. The third aspect would be maintaining a large facility about 1 million square feet. You need the manpower. And to get experienced manpower or trained manpower in India becomes a challenge. So I think these three would be my key challenges that I faced while building up the company.
We want to hear the Mishu and we want to hear your story as well.
So when we talk about challenges, so we have a very different approach from what Sudeep has. So of course, whilst he has tried to concentrate everything on all the customers at one place, we were going a different route. Completely. So we thought that, okay, instead of creating a large facility within a city or even going to multi-city, idea was to first address one location, one city, and address all the micro market locations issue. Because we believe today people do not want to travel, right? So as the traffic keeps on getting worse and worse today, each one of us, if we ask, I'm sure if we ask, if given an option, we would try to be as close to our residences in terms of workspaces as possible. Of course, the companies do not offer us that flexibility. I'm sure all of us face that challenge. But we thought that, okay, as a service provider, can I go to my customers, let's say, 2 years down the line, and I'd say that, okay, if you want to open an office in Gurgaon, I'll give you 10 different locations. Given the convenience of your employees, figure out the best location that works out. So since I'll give you a standardized offering in terms of the product, I'll give you a look, you know, one location at each and every micro market that you want to choose. And that's where we offer a bouquet or a vanilla, you know, a vanilla service presented in a bouquet wherein it's saying that everything is available and you can pick and choose where it's convenient. So what I believe three major challenges for any co-working space remains. The first is location. It has to be accessible by the employees because today employees also do not want to travel. So it's very unlike probably our, you know, most of us are probably around 40s. So when we used to pick up our jobs, we never thought about the location of the office. Getting a job in itself was a big, big thing. Today, employees are concerned about how convenient is it to reach the office as well. So that location remains the first prime concern. The second being the design of the space. At the end of the day, you end up spending more time in your office than you probably spend at home, at least while you're awake, right? So the spaces have to be designed right. Spaces have to inspire creativity. Spaces have to take care of productivity. If they're too lethargic as a space, it will eventually show in the way you actually operate in business as well. And that's the reason people are getting more and more conscious about, you know, how the workspace is. And that's the reason the shift to co-working spaces. Because if I'm a small business or if I'm trying to probably set up a satellite office, setting up a fancy or a cool office may not be that easy. And that's where a co-working should address the problem. The third is the community, because as she rightly said, Nidhi earlier mentioned, what's important is the co-work, the collaboration, the loneliness that we have, right? All of us, whether it's about work, whether it's homes. So when we go out today, we want to learn, but we want the ecosystem to be there to support us, to support our learning. So how as a co-working space do we bind that community together? How do we create opportunities for people to collaborate and grow together? Remains a challenge, and that's what we try to address.
Bharat, before I come to Nidhi. And
sure. So when I talk about, say, workspaces, everyone was looking towards services. So we did work around the services, but we wanted to go a step ahead. As Mishu also said, that since most of the time, the awake time is spent at the workspaces, and we have a global movement of sustainability. So our idea was to bring sustainability to workspaces and at an affordable level. So we planned and we said that, you know, whatever workspaces we will do in platinum rated, IGBC rated buildings. And other than that, our idea is that it's all about efficiency. So the environment should have maybe fresh air. It should have the green spaces. It should not feel like claustrophobic. So most of the spaces that are designed now, apart from coolness, it's really important to keep that openness, to get that productivity out of the person. So like by the end of the day, when people feel tired, it's mostly because of the fatigue and the oxygen levels coming down. So we have a live example of maybe many other places where efficiencies are treated by giving a better air quality. So there are studies that say that if you have a good environment around, the human health and comfort, when it's at its optimum level, throughout the day, you will have better efficiency.
Interesting. Nidhi and Anu, this is for both of you. Tell me, what is the market size of the co-living space right now? Is it an urban phenomenon? Where does it go from here?
So I can talk about student housing. The student housing market today is estimated to be over 20,000 crore, which is about 16 to 18 million students, growing at a 15% rate annually, right? And like I said, largely tier one and tier two concentrated. The two things that we are really banking on is one, the education sector growing, and B, the continuation of migration. I think these are the two trends that are here to stay. In our case, the way we look at student housing is, recession or no recession, students still have to go to college, parents still have to pay for their child's education, and still have the kids have to live somewhere safe, right? I think today parents look at housing as a part of the education investment holistically, right? So for us, the way we look at our business, this business is here to stay. Parents want to pay for a safe, comfortable living for their child, they value the community element, right? A lot of the kids in India are very pampered and have always been at home till the age of 17, 18. So this is their first step out of home. So the parents want to make sure that this is something which, you know, where the kids are comfortable. And because the parent is paying for this, I think they will, you know, we think there is a definitely a long-term demand for this product. And, you know, like we are betting on the education sector. So kids are going to study.
I'll take a little different approach from Nidhi in trying on the market size. So if you look at hospitality, there are about 200 million odd tourists in India every year. Their average duration of stay is about 2.5 nights. So you're talking of about 500 million plus minus kind of bed nights that's required in the hospitality space. That you compare with the hospitality ecosystem, which is, you know, right from your Ritz-Carlton and the Taj Palaces to Oyo, you know, even aggregating the unbranded hotels, that whole ecosystem is fairly mature. Whereas if you compare it with student housing, they're about, as Nidhi mentioned, about 18 million migrant students every year. They need to stay 365 nights every year. So you're talking of over 1,000 million plus bed nights that's required every year. And the gap is huge. You know, on-campus housing barely caters to over 10% of the demand. And whatever is existing is completely unorganized and a pretty bad product with no service standards whatsoever. So I believe over next decade, this industry overall, not just the product, but even the service quality will kind of evolve a lot.
So time for one last question to all of you. I start with you, Sudeep. Tell me, is the co-working phenomenon a solopreneur or an enterprise thing as well? And where do you see the market in the next 2 years, if I had to ask?
So it is both. It's solopreneur as well as enterprise. Largely, like I said, you know, our business focuses on enterprise. And that's where we see a large adoption or absorption of co-working as a space. What we're looking at in the next 2 years, by 2021, we're looking at 33% penetration in by these large companies into co-working spaces. So you'll see a lot of absorption. As of now, co-working is just about close to about 4 million square feet in the country. Next 2 years, there are predictions to that this will grow up to about, you know, 13.8 million odd square feet across the country. So that's like a huge shift. And when you know, talk about managed office services, large companies or large global MNCs are wanting to get into this. I just recently got to know that Google has signed about 10,000 seats with a single co-working across two locations. So that's like a huge bet. So if companies like Google are going towards you know, this phenomenon, then I think we see a very, very bright future.
For Mishu, is it urban or what's a tier 2 and tier 3 market like for you?
So I think tier 2 cities are still in a very nascent stage when it comes to co-working, but there's a huge potential there. Simply because a lot of workforce, when we talk about, you know, whether entrepreneurs or the employees come from these cities, the lack of proper infrastructure currently pushes them or probably warrants them to move to a tier 1 city. But, you know, today as a company, let's think from an employer's perspective. If I'm employing people from a certain tier 2 city or an area, the only reason why I have to get them inducted into, let's say, a tier 1 city is only because the infrastructure cannot be set up or is not available. However, vis-a-vis that, if I can limit my cost and I can still probably tie up with a service provider, even in terms of a workspace or a living, and say that, okay, yes, you know, whether it comes to co-living or co-working, the same infrastructure that I get in a tier 1 city is also available in a tier 2 city, I can probably, as an employer, cut down on my cost as well, and also making sure that the entrepreneurs and the employees are closer to where the roots are. I think overall, that's where the second level of growth will happen.
You agree, Bharat?
Oh, absolutely. So as Sudeep and Mishu said, you know, this industry is really about managed service spaces and getting closer to the employees and the users of such spaces. So I absolutely agree with both.
Anu and Nidhi, quick comments, 10 seconds. Do you have to do a lot of convincing to get business actually because of a new concept?
Sorry, what's that?
Do you have to do a lot of convincing to get new business because of a new concept?
You mean on the supply side?
Yes.
Not really. I think in most tier 1 cities, at least, there are players like OYO or Tribo who are there in the hospitality space, and hence landlords or property owners have kind of gotten a sense of the leasing model. In tier two cities, yes, it does kind of require a little more convincing, and specifically most of our business is tier two, tier three cities focused. So it does in those locations.
Yes.
I agree. And on the consumer side, I think the product, like Anu said, this is not a reinvention of the wheel. This is just the same product that has been, the basic hygiene levels have been corrected. And I think so that is something, it's not very hard to convince parents.
We have been given another 5 minutes. This is good news, yeah. Tell me, where do we stand in terms of global average of co-working spaces? Are we catching up fast? If we compare, are we at par with the kind of facilities we provide and the culture that we have that people opt for co-working spaces? I mean, give me a sense of that.
I think we are a long way from there, both in terms of the consumption today and both... I think as an industry per se, whether it's services, whether it's consumption, whether it's the expectation of the consumer. When we talk about, let's say, Western markets or more established markets, people have a certain level of service expectation here with. Whereas when we talk about India, currently it's still very cost sensitive. And there's always a cutthroat competition without actually putting in a value toward the proposition that you actually demand or want, right? So I think it's still a long way, but as I said, even co-working in India is in a very nascent stage. People are now waking up to the idea of moving to flexible workspaces. Also the fact that there's this sentiment of not owning assets anymore. I think this transition will happen over the next 5 to 10 years, wherein we'll see that, okay, the services level in itself going up to much, much higher levels.
Sudeep, do you see a phase in this space wherein you have niche co-working spaces meant for domain-specific, does it occur? Will it happen?
Absolutely, it will. I mean, just like any other category which has consolidated, over the last couple of years. I mean, just to give an example, if there's Flipkart, there's Amazon, doesn't mean a niche e-commerce player is not existent in the market. So you'll see a lot of, when the consolidation happens, you'll see a lot of, players coming in with specific niche segments. I've already been, somebody was telling me the other day that somebody's actually planning just a women-centric co-working space. So that'll be cool to see how it works here in India. We are, right now, the dynamics between India and the West are way different. If you see WeWork in US grew because there is largely a big population of startups and freelancers working out of WeWork. Unfortunately, in our country, it's only 3% that we have freelancers and startups who actually want to, can consume these spaces. So as a product in India, co-working has worked for large businesses, unlike the US, where there are short-term contracts. But I think in the service level, we are equally there in terms of what WeWork has to offer or anybody in the West has to offer.
Thank you, everyone. It's time's up for us. So thanks for these wonderful insights. Over to you. Yes.
Thank you.